Hey, good morning.
Good afternoon.
Good evening.
And good night.
And?
And?
Funk flex, look, machine.
I've been running shit so long, niggas hoping I finish soon. Praying on my downfall, hoping to see a nigga lose. Fuck the opposition minuscule. Run up in that spot, police find the shell cases in that living room. Thought it was over, but I came back with digger jewels. Sold out arenas like a nigga played for Liverpool. 10 bad bitches in my swimming pool. Funny, cause niggas said I remind them of Big, now me and Diddy cool. I'm rich now, but I'm still a goon. Freedom niggas shitting big balloons soon as they leave the visit room. I'm back stadiums, you niggas couldn't fill a room. I was just shooting for the stars when I hit the moon. Yeah. Now niggas thinking that I signed for millions. I mean, I did, but still, mind your business. Niggas counting my paper that I find offensive. I get the letting off this Drake when niggas find offensive.
All right, so there you have it. Cipha and I nailed it. We've never been more right in terms of breaking down what's going to happen in history.
Yeah.
And there it is. You have the Funk Flex Conway makeup. The only difference is Cipha. I made sure to privately inject myself into this conversation.
Okay.
I flexed it from the Rosenberg spot.
To flex or to Conway?
Well, to both. I dealt with both of them on it.
Okay.
I forced my way into being involved.
I love it.
Because I should be, as the person who plays the most of it.
What was the suggestions you made?
Well, I just hit flex and I just talked about it the first night. And and I could tell from jump he was not serious. Like, this was a flex. This was a tap. He was tapping Conway the way he tapped me. This was not.
Absolutely.
We'll talk about the Pete Rock. That wasn't a tap. That was not a love tap. This was a love tap.
All connected, bro.
It's
all in the flex universe. You people, and I'm talking about black people. No, I'm just kidding. You people, meaning Juan Ep fans, got an inside look step by step of how flex does flex.
Yep.
And a lot of people don't see this. And it's still right there. Why is he on an old school beat when he called everybody old?
Yep. Flex be flexing. That's what he's doing right there.
Why is he on an old school beat? Also, Conway and those Griselda guys normally don't rhyme on up-tempo beats. They're very
not really at all.
Tempo, druggy, marijuana street beats, right? So who picked the beat? And who's the most comfortable with that beat? Flex is. Now, did Flex convince Conway to go, hey, if it's on this beat, I'll play it a lot more? Did Conway try to appeal to Flex's old school sensibility?
My guess is Flex's was very direct. Like, this would be hard if you did this.
Right.
This would be hard.
So he flexed them.
He flexed them. That's my guess. And Conway is a smart dude. And Conway and I texted this morning, and he wanted to make very clear that all of us at least me, Ebro, and Laura, no one felt slighted, which, of course, no one did except me and the fact that I felt left out of the conversation. No one else cared. But, like, he clearly is, like, he meant some of the things that he said.
Yeah.
But he didn't mean he's not trying to be the dude shitting on all his radio relationships and not appreciating the support. He very clearly gets it. And so while Flex flexed him, Conway handled it like a pro. And he's turning it into, and I said to Conway, I said, yo, now it's time for us to get a record done and let's fucking push on the gas right now. Let's 100%. Keep going.
So who won?
They both did.
Everyone wins.
Everyone wins.
Which is a flex move. You just got flexed. Not only did Flex win.
You just got butt slammed.
Not only did Flex win, Conway won.
Yep.
And even you won.
Maybe. I hope so. I think I'm going to get my record done now.
Or you could win. You have the potential.
I have a better potential to win now than I did a week ago.
Absolutely. And that's everyone wins. Somehow, Pete Rock gets dragged.
Oh, no. No win for Pete here. Let's
no
see.
Win.
No. This is, I don't even, all he did was jump in. And here, let's see if I have it and I can play it properly without it. Let me get through the advertisement. I'm looking at a guy standing in the woods. A blue car drives by. He's looking through a window with binoculars.
Is that a Vince Staples commercial?
No.
Oh.
That would make sense, though, because it's a rap video, but not. Now, the second commercial is a dental thing going on.
Okay.
I'll take this
4 out of 5 dentists?
I'll take this time while the dentist... disgusting dentist commercials playing to say, go please. If you are enjoying the push that we are doing here of Juan Ep, if you're feeling the vibes, we need you to rate and review. I'm going to be blunt, okay? Yeah. I'm going to be blunt.
Blood like Geronimo.
Royal Flush, okay? That all group, Infamous Syndicate. I meant Relativity. I left blunt. Sorry. Anyways, here's the deal. There are shows, there are jabroni shows out there that are ranked higher than us because their people review it more often and more regularly and more recently, and they have new subscribers. And Juan Epp should not be hovering. Listen, I don't care. That's why we haven't mentioned it very much, because we don't look at it very much anymore. But as we make this push, Juan Epp shouldn't be 50th on the podcast, music fucking podcast. I'm not going to live 49 spots below Joe Budden, okay? I know he's a very compelling guy, but give me a break. What the fuck is Joe saying that's 49 spots more interesting than what we're doing on 1F? Just because he's yelling louder?
Yeah, he's a loud yeller.
I can think of, there's no reason for it. There's no reason for it.
He's not lying, guys. He's not wrong.
I'm not wrong.
Hit us up.
Subscribe. Like.
Subscribe on YouTube. Whatever. Hit the notifications on YouTube.
Yes,
and
we need
also,
that.
Also, Apple Podcast review and all that shit.
And Billy June even managed to—he even managed to switch the name to One Up His Life. By the way, amazing Billy June story to tell you with regard to the interview with Danger Mouse and Black Thought.
Oh, okay.
Just a little Billy June tidbit for you. As well as we have several other things we have to get into today, including—I'm guessing you didn't watch the January 6th hearing last night.
No.
This is the one day. There have been a lot of days where someone brings it up and you're just like, why are you telling me this is boring? This is the one day where you should be happy to be talking to me. Yeah, I'll give you some good shit.
Okay, good. But listen, real quick, as much as you sit there and you fucking text chicks with big old chimneys trying to get them to come over at night, same real quick, just write a little review. How much you love the show, how we were the first ones to ever do it, and people need to listen. Come on, guys. Come on.
I don't know, don't know if you've heard a little gap in the, you know, male hip hop New York perspective has opened up this week. I don't know if anyone's aware of that.
No,
it's time to push the fucking gas. And by the way, you patrons out there who pay your $7.50 every month, we would love for you to do it too, but you're doing your part. I'm asking the thousands of other people listening for free every week.
Yeah.
You're not even paying on Patreon. Just go give us some comments and some ratings and the sub on YouTube.
The fuck is your problem, man?
Our guy Emilio Sparks out here, we're producing videos every week now that actually looks legitimate.
And I know we're pushing a lot of promo. I'm sorry, but if you're ready to support me, man, come see my live comedy stand-up live album recording August 1st. Over at the Village Underground in Greenwich Village, a Comedy Cellar, August 1st, 8 o'clock, 10 o'clock. Make a reservation on comedycellar.com. Don't bullshit around. Make a goddamn reservation.
Monday, August
1st. Fucking Jabron. What is it?
Jabroni.
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 You fucking jabronis.
Yeah, Jabroni makes it sound like, what's that comedian's name?
Maddie Murphy.
No. Maz
Jabroni.
Maz Jabroni. Yeah. Is that his name?
I think so.
It is that, right? Anyways, so real quick. Oh, yeah. We got to hit the Desus Mero thing for a second. We got to hit the January 6th situation, the Billy June story from Danger Mouse and Black Thought. But first, let's see if this is the work. Because last week we mentioned the Pete and Flex, and people were upset we didn't break it down a little further. So we're going to give you that. We listen to the people. Let's see if this is it.
Pete Rock and Funkmaster Flex.
All right, so someone talking about it.
I was disappointed. And then I was going to just scrap with him in his comments. And then he feels like he wants to take it further and say what a rotten person I am and a DJ and this, that, that. And I'm taking payola and everything. So he wanted to give his opinion of me on his platform, and now I'm taking my platform to give my opinion of him. So this guy, I think he referred to himself as working at WBLS Hot 97, right? Let's first clear that up, my friend. It was Molly Mall's show. Okay. You are Molly Mall's son.
I mean, that's not even, that shouldn't even be a diss, honestly. You know, I mean, that's not a diss. You're Flex's son.
I am Flex's son, but I didn't go around saying from 1997 to 2000, whatever, I was on the radio on my show. It was Flex's show.
Correct. Okay. Good point.
You never talk about him. You never big him up. You learned everything that you do from Marley Marl.
Stop.
Is that true?
See how I always big up Flex?
Yeah, because you never want that.
I don't want that.
Is that true? Does he not bring up Marley?
I mean, I never really heard him talk about it. Not really.
And because, by the way, it wasn't just, you have to remember, it wasn't just BLS. They came back together on Hot 97 for Future Flavors.
Yep. Yep.
So it's two runs that Pete and Marley had together.
Okay, let's start there. And you were on the radio, and it was cute. This was 1990, my brother. No, I'm sorry, 88, 89. You were on the radio 32 years ago. 32. Let me tell you. 32 years ago, you were on the radio.
Wow.
32. You think things have changed just a little bit since then? No, right? You don't think so, right? I know you don't.
This is on the air.
This is all on the air. Now, by the way, I should just add here. If it was in fact 88 that Pete started, if it ended in 90, it's 32. If it started in 88, it's 34 that it started.
Are you mansplaining math to Flex?
That's right, Flex. I just want to help you.
You get the gist.
A long time ago.
Damn, that's.
Should I jump ahead? Should I jump ahead because this is long.
Yeah.
All right. Go, you're on the radio.
Mind you, pause 1 second. Just on some hip hop nerd shit. I don't want to make it seem like I'm taking Flex's side because he is my mentor and my friend. And I wouldn't have anything if it wasn't for that guy. I also very much love Pete Rock.
Me too. And we should probably reach out. We probably should.
Yes, but this is very funny. But also, I'm letting you know as a hip hop connoisseur.
Yeah,
I love Pete Rock, and in no way am I trying to disrespect this guy.
I do not
like when people say Flex takes money. I promise you, of all the years I've been with Flex at Hot 97 back in the day, the two things he told me the first day I started was never take money to play a record, and never let these industry dudes or these record label dudes get in your ear. And like smooze me to try to convince Flex to play a record. And I didn't know what he was talking about until years later when record companies promotion guys started to schmooze me. You know what I mean? Now, have I gone out to record company events and had dinners and even gotten paid to like DJ a record label Christmas party or blah, blah, blah? Yes. But he's talking about brown paper bag. Here's some money, play this song. Never once have I taken money, and I know for a fact Flex hasn't taken money. Now, do labels buy advertisement on radio stations?
Yes. Oh, yeah. Are there dicey things? Was there a time when I was at a radio station and Master P dropped off a check for $10,000, and then the next day we're doing the Master P PT Cruiser contest and they're playing all of a sudden his record in rotation? That, yes. By the way, that's not a Hot 97 story, but yes, of course, things like that happen in radio. But like now, Cipha, have you ever seen money in like an envelope inside a record case?
Me personally, no, but I've heard about it, of course.
Yeah, me too, and I've never seen it either. I have been offered money a handful of times. Yo, you know there was someone in our someone left a comment somewhere that one of the fucking people in our Discord put up there.
Yeah.
That said someone said he like posted a text message from someone and they blurred the dude's name out. And yeah. He's like, everyone knows Rosenberg takes money for real late. You know, like $8,000 will get you like 9 weeks of spins. It was the craziest shit. Bro, who do you think I play that has that much disposable income to give me?
I'm talking about $400, $500. You offer me $8,000, I'm going in. I'm going in.
I got to find the quote. It's so crazy. Yo, and it annoyed me that the dude in our Discord even posted it. Yeah. It was like,
I do you not like us, people on our Discord? Yo, like, what's the problem?
I swear to God, they barely like us.
What, why are you here? No, why are you here?
Even the people who like us the most, I swear to God, I don't think they really like us. Like, hold on, I gotta find it. I mean, it's so crazy. Even what's homegirl's name, Karma, who's always commenting.
Yeah.
Even she the other day in the conversation about how people say I take money. She's like, really? If he takes money, why is he wearing the same chains every week? I was like, wait, what? First of all, how many chains do I have to wear? I have a few. That's it. I'm not a West Side
Gun. Look at his outfit. You think he takes money? Huh?
That's what they're doing. And I'm like, do you have to do it that way? Why is that the only way to defend me?
I love that. I love it.
Hold on. I still haven't been able to find the actual quote from this guy.
Well, finish the Pete Rock and then go back to the quote.
I'll find that in the meantime. Good idea. Back to Flex and Pete Rock. I jumped ahead a bit.
He has an amazing radio voice. That's the only people wanted beats or remixes from you, my friend.
What happened?
Which I can't believe that's how you're getting down, my brother. So you're suing Nas. Who else he's suing? He's suing Oz. Eddie F. Eddie F is Heavy D's DJ from Heavy D and the Boys, New York, who was, and will continue to be very important in the music business. And he put that buffoon on. Now he's suing him.
Oh, Pete, pause right there. In case you don't know, in case you're a little bit of a younger listener.
Go ahead.
Heavy D and Pete Rock are cousins, first cousins. Despite, they're cousins. And Eddie F, who was Heavy D's producer and DJ, took on Heavy D's little cousin and taught him how to make beats and stuff. You know what I'm saying?
Okay.
So I don't know what he's talking about suing him, but yeah, that's the guy who really put Pete Rock on.
Mm. Okay, I guess some people wouldn't know Eddie F. It's true.
Oh, remixes. You're doing a lot of remixes in production, my brother. But you know what you forgot since you were a little
what?
Stupid. When you did those remixes, you took the money up front. You didn't do your royalties. You didn't do any royalties for those. So now when you hear those spinning on the radio and you see it on Apple and Spotify and what's the other one called? Tidal. Sorry, Jay. I'm sorry. I'm not. Man, I apologize again, man. Now when you see it on those places, you don't get any money for it. That's why you're so upset, because your money's tight. Mm. You remember.
Okay, that's a good point.
You were calling my office.
What? Which part?
So, okay. We'll get into a little bit of music industry shit. Right, hip hop is a very young genre. It's not handled like other music businesses sometimes. So, being a producer is way different than being a beat maker. But in hip hop, it just became the norm to call the beat maker the producer, produced by, when technically production is a lot more. Now back then, so now. A remix when, like, you heard, like, Just a Man, Das Effects remix.
Oh, God.
Or House of Pain, Jump Around remix. Mm. There's a lot of legal jargon when it comes to songs and remixes. So now, back in the day, before hip-hop, a remix was you take the actual song and you boost the level. You technically remix it. You go into the studio and mix it again, because now if you're going to make it a single, you want the bass to boom more, or you want the intro to be a little longer for like dance records or whatever, or you're doing a dance remix. So that's what it is. It's like you're kind of like changing the levels and stuff. Somehow, and I credit a lot of this to Puff, he would take a song and make a completely new beat. Like the Jodeci, Can I Talk to You remix. Mm-hmm. Because remix was the term that they used, but it's really not a remix. He made a new beat.
It's a new record.
So what I'm saying is, when you deal with a remix of a song, you're not dealing with the A&Rs and the music part of a record company. You're dealing with the marketing side and the promotion side, because they want to somehow increase the awareness of a song or an album. So they would take a song that wasn't so good and they would try to do a new version of it, and it's just a remix. But since it's going through the marketing department, you're just getting a fee, even though you made a completely new beat. Now, Pharrell and them, when it comes down, we start getting into the 2000s, Pharrell and them was like, no. You're not just going to give us a fee for remixing this song. We actually made a new song. So we need publishing. We need royalties. We need all that. So open up that album budget.
And get me in there. Yeah,
and
exactly.
We get official royalties to this new song that I made. Because sometimes a remix will have different lyrics.
Well, and then on the flip side, with some of Pete's records, you know, sometimes they were not bigger than the original. Or like, you know, this one, for example, we love, but it's not. This was him just doing it. This one probably made sense to get the money up front. Like, obviously, you'd rather get the residuals also. But this is different than, say, the Neptunes remixing La 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 for Jay-Z. Excuse me, Miss Part 2.
Yeah, that's a whole different song.
Because this is a monster. The original's a monster. People don't really play this right. One. We do.
Yeah, the hip-hop does, yeah.
But to your point, yes.
Well, that one's a little weird because that was a that white group.
But this one.
And then the white song blew up in the white world. But they were like, no, we still want to make a rap version. You know what I'm saying?
But this one's bigger, way bigger than the original.
Absolutely. I guarantee he just got a remix fee.
You play this? When people play this, by the way, it's not like I hate this song, but when people in a set play that and not the remix, it does drive me absolutely insane.
I like it because it's like, oh, I never hear this version once in a while, because the Pete Rock one is the one, of course.
Even though it's still cool.
Yeah.
I hear what you're saying. But after a second, I want...
Yeah, you should mix the two. Yeah. So anyway, that's a lot of what that's a little hip hop music jargon.
That's very interesting though, to think about that. All right, back to the Flex and Beat.
I can. Sometimes when a person has a partner and knows, hey man, they might pull him over. He may have something in that car. They might go up in that apartment and they may know where you keep stuff. And then they send the police to your house. Mm. What type of guy is that?
Oh, yeah, that's
And you talk to me about the game and integrity. You have none, my friend.
Jeez. I pause right there. I understand what he's saying. That's why Rosenberg has never been to my house. Because I don't trust the fact that one day shit might go left.
And I'll call the police.
He's going to send police
to your house
to go get my stash.
You know what? It's a reasonable claim.
That's how we stay friends.
Right.
That's why there's no crazy big breakup between Cipha Sounds and Rosenberg.
Ooh, good segue, Cipha. Because that's really all there is to say. I mean, listen, we're not going to play Flex just crushing him. We're not taking sides on it. It sucks. Yes, is it entertaining? Yes. And does it lead to good conversation? Sure. But we love Pete. Listen, I disagree with Pete on many things. Okay. Just follow him on Twitter. It's very easy to disagree with a lot of things Pete says. But, you know, I love the guy and love and the music. I mean, he's one of my absolute all-time favorites. That'll never change.
I can't tell you how his music, his DJing, the pre-Rock Sales Move albums and all outside production shaped my love for hip hop in the early 90s. So I can't take that away ever.
No, he's got
no matter what. I sat with Pete Rock in Japan and he's out to lunch, bro. He's out to lunch.
You mean in terms of
we were having dinner. Me and my wife, him and his wife, he happened to be DJing in Japan while I was there on vacation. We ran into him at a club. I was so excited. Pete Rock, we're like, you know what I mean? We went and had
dinner. Always say vacation that way? Vacation.
No, sorry. Vacation. I think I was coughing. On holiday. We were on holiday.
You were on holiday?
On holiday.
Oh, on holiday in Japan together. Okay.
Bro, and in the middle of dinner, he just gets up and leaves. I thought he was going to the bathroom. He never came back. He never came back. So I asked his wife, I go, hey, what happened to Pete? And she went, oh, there has to be a record store around here. And we finish dinner, we pay, and then we look around the block and there's a record store and he's sitting in there digging for records. And I say, yo, does he do this? And she goes, all the time when we're by ourselves, he'll just get up and leave.
Yeah, no, Pete's an interesting cat. You know, there's no doubt about it. And Pete, you know, listen, Pete's an interesting story in the industry. He did have some things that didn't go great. We know the I&I Electra situation was a disaster. And that really left him bitter about a lot of things in the industry. But he continued to make great shit. I mean, don't ever forget in your life.
Ladies and gentlemen.
I'd like to know.
Are you ready for start time?
Yeah! Okay, well, let me kind of move these things around here, you know.
Ladies and gentlemen, I don't know what this is coming down through the audience, but look like it just came out of the basement.
You know what I'm saying? You know what I'm saying?
Thank you, because calls now.
All right, let's bring to the stage.
Yeah. Your Highness, live from the brick 1-6. Pete Rock, bang your head, break the drumsticks. Total assault.
This is such a Rosenberg Pete Rock beat.
It's not my favorite Pete Rock beat.
Wait, play,
no,
play,
one of my let me give my favorite beat on the album. Okay. My favorite beat on the album.
This is Pete Rock solo album.
Right? Soul Survivor. Yep. Here's my favorite beat on the album, I believe.
Word of mouth, word of mouth. Like this show. The whole package.
I only played True Master first because it was the single.
Bring it in, like, say.
The way the pianos come in when CL starts.
Oh, man.
Introducing CL, then face defeats. And I remind you of 3rd Street when it was sweet. See this move on and grow to another plateau where me and Steve having that dough. In the last days when critical times...
Yo, sheesh. I'll tell you this, man. The same way I have my one version of Premiere I love and the second version, not as much. Same with Pete.
You don't love this, Pete?
I don't love the slow beats, Pete. I love the up-tempo horns. Pete Rock and CL Smooth album cuts.
How about this one?
Thumb heads. What? Cherry heads.
They're all different. This whole album is not, for sure, this is not horns Pete Rock.
I feel like this album is all beats CL might have rejected, which is fine. It's still dope beats.
Float on this magnificent track, wise, intelligent, all-star American. Yes, the rap set.
I'll tell you what this album definitively has, though. Some unnecessary Pete Rock verses on songs.
Oh, does this, what's the album with Onyx, why can't think of the guys from Onyx's name? Sticky Fingers.
Yeah, yeah. You mean this?
Yeah. What is this? Is that Tragedy?
Yep.
Oh, is this Strange Fruit?
That's right.
Oh, play Sticky Fingers part. He said one of the illest lines I love. I haven't heard this in so long.
World plant seeds in my mind, strange fruit.
This was a bootleg first. It didn't originally have Capadonna and Sticky Fingers. It was just like Gaddafi and
right.
Niggas see me in the club, start ducking and tucking they link. Like I resorted to robbing niggas for table scraps. In the hood, we do away with cats. In the river, do away the gaps. Hey, where I go, turn cops in. You know what I mean? Don't make me trip, make me flip. Be so much bloodshed, you think I'm crap. Even before I
oh, I love that line, bro.
Be so much bloodshed, you think I'm Crip?
Bro, you don't make me flip. There'll be so much bloodshed, you think I'm Crip. That is a fire bar.
So much on this album. If you've never listened to it, this one.
Wait, one more. You got Rakim.
And yo, it's such a shame. All these dick riders trying to corrupt the game. But what it bring? Nothing but pain and one in your fucking brain.
Ain't nothing changed since the album. I'm still wild and I'm still violent. I've been waiting for this moment like Phil Collins.
For my life, I'm trying for this right. I put a knife, fighting the fight. Tonight is the night. And I ain't even trying to let a nigga slide.
Oh, I know what you want to hear. I know exactly what you want to hear. Because this is one of the great late era Pete's. Oh, my.
Yes. Yes.
He's just hitting the buttons on the MP.
Here we go. Yep. This is it.
And my name is Rakim.
Yo, yo.
Fire.
And my name is Rakim. Yo, yo. And my name is Rakim. Yo, yo. And my name is Rakim. And my name is Rakim. Yo, yo. Rakim, yo. The song begins. My eyes
yo, can we get Pete on?
You want to?
We have to.
We can ask him. Yeah, we can ask him.
We got to. Anyway.
And by the way, last thing I'll say about Pete, because Flex painted a picture of a lot of this shit being from a long time ago. Let's not forget about this much later. This is only 12, 13 years old.
32 years ago.
32. Pete Rock, let the needle drop. You know, I've probably told everyone listening this a million times before, but this song means so much to me because when I met Jay-Z the second time, when he came to the radio station and sat in the studio doing an interview with Tigger, who was out of town, and I was running the board. It was just me and Hove in the room. And I asked him who his favorite producers were. And I asked him why he hadn't done a song with Pete Rock. And he was like, oh, I love Pete, you know, just haven't gotten a chance to, you know, blah, blah, blah. And then so when this record finally got made, I was like, wow, it took a long time. He finally got a song with Pete Rock after you ever thought it would have happened.
Right.
Way after. Like the book was closed on Jay-Z and Pete Rock.
Yeah.
And by the way, drives me crazy, but shout to Kanye for that. That's Kanye always staying in contact with people he admires. I think. Yeah. I think that's how that happened.
Yeah. That's Kanye's album. Yeah. Is that Kanye's album? Or that's Watch the Thrones?
Throne.
Oh, yeah. Watch the Thrones. Yeah.
Add a little sugar. By the way, as we're recording, this is my birthday tomorrow. So.
Is it your birthday tomorrow?
So, and I got to get, and guess what? They're calling for 0% chance of rain.
The 23rd?
That's right.
Why don't I have that in my calendar?
Well, that's terrible.
I'm sorry, I'll put it in right now.
You usually send a text to Shawnee Culture on my birthday, which is a weird tradition.
I never forget your birthday because Shawnee Culture will hit me up. It's also the birthday of Haile Selassie. Rastafari. So Shawnee Culture, formerly being a former Rastafarian, told us that.
I think current Rastafarian.
Current, but like not maybe not as practicing.
Sure.
That Wata will touch the earth on
Wata
July 23rd.
Always touch upon the earth.
So there is a game we've played for the last, I don't know, 15 years. 32 years ago. The last 15 years, Shawnee Culture will point out that it will rain sometime between midnight and 11:59 on July 23rd in our area or wherever we are. So let's see.
Let tomorrow 0%. So it's going to be very interesting. And
Get Shawnee on.
I like to troll Shawnee by playing this too.
Just Rastafarianism. Yes, I Ross Trent.
Cipha, have you ever watched this video?
Yeah, of course.
You know what best me champion sound.
See, here's the thing about Lonely Island, okay? And why, like, some people miss them And the reason I think Cipha and I laugh so hard at this, it's not just that they're making fun of white boys who have dreads and fucking go to Phish concerts and play hacky sack. It's the details to what he's saying in the song because they are fans of black music and know the things to say.
They know the absolute right things to say, and they're saying it correctly, even though they're making fun of, they're not making fun of it.
No, they're making fun of the person who would claim this shit. Yeah. But they know it because they are that also. Here we go.
Yeah.
Boy living in the shanty dorms. My roommate Nick is an ignorant bald head. Now shant down Babylon, midterm essays. Then pop from the chalice I be made from a Sprite can. Last week I read a book about Selassie I. Then told my boba clot parents I was switching religions.
Excuse me.
Oh, hot stepper.
You do so many dutty crimes. Shouts to Lonely Island. You want to call Shawnee?
Oh, shit. Real quick, yeah.
Shawnee Culture, who looks like he's transported himself right now, like, to some sort of tropical place.
Shawnee, good to see you, my brother.
My brother. What's going on, family?
We've got an interesting topic to discuss. It's very important. Apparently, I forgot, but it was reminded that tomorrow is Rosenberg's birthday.
Yes.
July 23rd.
The first day of the lion.
That's right.
The lion.
You know what I'm saying?
Rastafari.
And
Rastafari.
Subscribe to the people real quick. It is also the birthday of who?
Rastafari Makunen, which Ras means prince. Tafari Makunen is his name, who later became the Haile Selassie I, the emperor, king of kings.
Oh, Ras means prince?
Ras means prince. So he was born Prince Tafari Makunen.
His name is Tafari.
Tafari.
Yo, I'm telling you this right now. This trivia right here would be wrong from every single person who's not a Rastafari in themselves.
100%. I never
100%
knew that.
Would not know that it's Tafari and it's Ras Tafari.
Right. And that makes sense because I have seen Ras on other things, but I thought they were just paying tribute to Rastafari. But now Ras means prince in Ethiopian.
Yes.
Wow. And then so then he changed his name to Haile Selassie.
Yeah, he was coronated emperor. When he became emperor, they gave him a new name, which is Haile Selassie.
Which I noticed that a lot, especially when you watch, like, when I watch The Crown, and when they become king or whatever, their name changes.
Yeah, they get, like, more of a godly name. It's almost like being baptized. Or maybe, I don't know if a bar mitzvah is the same. Maybe you get a...
No.
You don't get, like, a new
name. No one
name.
Gives you a cool name. No,
you get a new name?
You get, you get some gift cards, you know?
Yeah.
You know, you get a...
You tell me when you become a man, you get some gift cards to Buffalo Wild Wings.
Yeah, you get a gift card to Buffalo Wild Wings and Toys R Us. You might get a new Sega or something. Wait, and by the way, Haile Selassie I, is I being the first?
I is the first. So this is Selassie I, but it's really Selassie.
It's really Haile Selassie, and really you could say Haile Selassie the first, technically, but first of his name.
Yeah, Haile Selassie, you could say the first, you say Selassie I.
Oh, Selassie I. Oh, look at this.
Now, and by the way, here's how dumb I am. I mean, every day I discover something that makes me realize how little I've understood my entire life.
Correct.
I worked at Ross Records, okay? And I never realized that Ross means prince. All I took is that Gary Himmelfarb, who started the label, and basically was Ross Trent, he called the label Real Authentic Sound, Ross.
Right.
But I didn't realize it was a double meaning. It was homage, of course, to Haile Selassie by just calling it Ross. But I didn't quite realize that.
Right. I kind of double acronym it too with Ross for Rastafari and saying Ross Culture or Ras Shani Culture, but Ross is an acronym for Runaway Slave, which you know is my logo.
Hello.
You know what I'm saying?
Runaway slave. And also Rasputin.
Rasputin?
Yeah, he was a prince of Russia.
Yeah, that has nothing to do with this. Hey, Saif.
Also, he wasn't the
prince. I also, unrelated, we'll get back to Haile Selassie and Rain in a second, but Saif, I also realized, do you think that EST, do you think that EST from Three Times Dope?
Three Times Dope, yeah.
The EST is the last three letters in greatest, like greatest man alive. Because on greatest man alive, it keeps saying EST. I'm the greatest EST, man alive.
Greatest man alive. Yeah.
You think
we got to call J1s. We got to call J1s.
I'm going to call J1s. We're going to call J1s.
Okay. Well, anyway, so
right, back to Shawnee and
Shawnee, our theory for the last 15 years that we've known Peter Rosenberg.
Yes.
What is happening tomorrow?
So each and every year since I have been told when I was 18 and baptized Rasta in the temple, there was a lady who was speaking, one of the daughters, as we say. She said it rains every year without fail. And I was like, I never noticed that, which most people won't unless you bring it to their attention, that whether it is a thunderstorm, whether it rains all day, or whether it's just a sun shower, water will touch the earth on Heidi Sufensi's birthday. And ever since then, I paid attention. And without fail.
Without fail. I've been paying attention for 15 years since I've known Rosenberg. Maybe, is it 15 years?
Yeah.
You've been on the radio for 15 years, right?
That's right.
Okay. So for 15 years since Shawnee told me this, we talk about this every year. It has rained. But like the earth is very big and flat.
Right. Right.
So somewhere it's going to rain. Are you talking about in New York or wherever Peter is?
I always question that part because I'm like, right. Does it sprinkle everywhere? So I know a few people that share the same birthday as July 23rd in different parts of the world. So I asked them because I need to know.
Yeah.
And they say it rains too.
It rains every time.
Wherever.
Somewhere.
So everywhere. So in every area in the world.
It's baffling. And the one time.
Yeah, there's like the spiritual being that is sending the water to touch the earth know the borders of each city. And but like, yo, there's been some years where, you know, especially we do the morning show. So we're up at like 4 o'clock, 5 o'clock, and we'll go to work and it doesn't rain all day and it doesn't rain in the afternoon or at night. And Shawnee will go and look up, I don't know, some kind of farmer's almanac and be like, yo, it rained at 2 a.m. before we went to work.
I was just about to say that. I think it was 2 years that I was like, mind blown, like, it's going to happen. And it didn't happen.
Yeah.
And then I look it up and I'm like, oh, it rained at 2 a.m.
Yeah.
I was like, wow.
Isn't that crazy? Really wild.
So everybody, you're up, man. You have to let us know if it, well, this will be, when you hear this, it'll be in the past, but.
Did you notice that it rained on Saturday?
Saturday, July 23rd. Watch her.
You really have to pay attention because it won't necessarily be in the forecast.
It's not.
Oh, that's the whole thing, Rosen. That's why I called you.
0%.
Right.
They're saying zero.
Did it say that it was going to rain yesterday? Because yesterday, the thunder clapped for a quick 20 minutes.
It came down.
What are you saying? Are you saying Rastafari doesn't know it's a leap year? Is that what you're saying?
No, I'm saying.
What does yesterday have to do with it? We're talking about Saturday.
Right. Well, I'm saying.
He's just saying the principle.
Right. The predictability of the weather forecast and their technology versus God's, you know, movement. Yesterday, I don't know if I saw rain in the prediction. The weather was the same, basic same humidity. Mm. And out of nowhere, bow.
Tons of clap.
20 minutes, it got dark. It clapped and went away. So I'm saying, even though it says 0% for tomorrow, we may see a similar circumstance, is my point.
Right, well, we'll see.
Out of nowhere.
Shawnee, thank you so much. We'll regroup on the Patreon episode to get us the final word on the rain on July 23rd. Mm. Look, Rosenberg turns 50 years old.
43.
May God bless the day. Let the rain come down. Happy birthday, Peter Rosenberg. May your life and your day be a blessing.
Maybe he's an Ethiopian Jew.
Maybe. Maybe. All connected.
Yo, peace, Shawnee.
Peace, Shawnee. Yo,
bless you, bro. Ja lives.
Sage words from Shawnee culture. Thank you, Shawnee. And by the way, I just said one of the things that makes Lonely Island great is their attention to detail. We didn't know Ross meant Prince.
No.
They did. They named him Ross Trent. They, even in their joke, they understood. Now, let's play a game.
Okay.
The game is called What would Cipha Sounds and Peter Rosenberg have to do to get a modicum of the attention that Desus and Mero got for their breakup?
Now, mind you, I love Desus and Mero. I have definitely fallen off since they went to Showtime, which I, you know, okay, another flex theory in life.
Go ahead.
Don't go and take that big money if it's going to take some of the eyes off of you, right?
Mm-hmm.
Flex always used to tell me, I don't make a lot at the radio because I want to be on the box every day. I'm going to make all my money doing my outside outside ventures.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, when you have a free show that's on 4 days a week and then you go to Showtime, yes, you get paid. But I think their popularity had to diminish a little bit when they went over there.
Well, yeah, it didn't ever rate. It didn't do well as a show. I don't think it ever got ratings or anything. I think it was reaching the core fans who stuck with it. But I don't know if it rated at Vice. They were always big on the podcast and on Twitter.
Vice, bro, did that, bro. So my boy put me on.
Vice felt like it was hitting more people.
Yeah, for sure.
Okay.
Because here's the thing with Vice.
The format changed too. It wasn't just
100%.
Format 100%.
Changed. Yeah, because you're getting all that money. Everybody's when you got something raw. And then you start putting money into it. Everybody has their say. Well, we should do it more like this. More lights, more this, more that. The Vice studio was ghetto as fuck, man. It was just them at a table with a pair.
Yeah,
bear,
no, you know I mean? Remember. No, they never had me on the show.
Oh, you didn't go on there? Do you know the bear wasn't wearing the Timberlands?
Oh, really?
It was just in front of the foot.
Huh.
Anyway, that's what I just want. But I'm just telling you, so they were on 4 days a week. So if you're a person that watches TV late at night and you're flicking the channels,
you have a better chance
of hitting it.
Correct. That makes sense on
flipping channels. You know, everything's changed.
And it played to their strength. It played to their strength of being like loose and kind of being like
loose,
a podcast.
Late night, fuck, say whatever. You know what I mean?
Yeah, the Showtime shit was a little more polished up.
So my boy put me on to the envy situation that they had. Oh my God, that shit was.
You didn't know about that? Hell.
I kind of remember hearing about it, but I never watched it when Envy dissed them on the show and then they went on the air that night. Oh, they went in, bro. That shit was so fucking funny.
And wait, they went in after they did. It was after they did the Breakfast Club.
Yeah. But they said one thing before, which made Envy mad. And then when they went to do the Breakfast Club, he was like, yo, you got to apologize to my wife. And they were, why? He played the clip, whatever. And then he walked out on them.
Right, right, right.
He walked out of the studio. And then that night, they laid into him.
Oh, God. That was one of their biggest moments, actually.
Really? The Envy thing?
I think it's up there. It was definitely a big talking point for a while.
Right.
So back to the game, Cipha.
Yeah, okay.
How much would we have to do? I'm going to throw a scenario at you.
Yeah.
And you tell me whether it would have gotten close to like the 36 hours of constant trending about Desus and Mero leaving their Showtime show and their podcast. Okay.
Yeah.
So if, if one of us went on vacation and had one of our legs gnawed off by an alligator.
Yeah.
And it was filmed. And the video went around on Twitter.
Yeah.
And in the video, like you saw screaming and blood gushing everywhere, but like fighting back against the alligator. And the video was out everywhere.
Yeah.
Do you think that would get us as much attention as their breakup?
No, it would not. It would not.
Okay. What if we were on vacation together?
Okay. Here we go.
And same alligator.
Okay.
Kills both of us same time. And
kills us.
Kills us. You and I
kills both of us.
We are maimed and murdered by an alligator, the same one that took off the hand of Chubbs Peterson and Happy Gilmore. That alligator eats both of us. Does that get the same attention?
Yes.
All right. So you do think that with double death, we would need double death.
Both killed together.
Okay. What if you and I were killed 6 months apart in separate alligator accidents?
It would get a lot, not as much. No.
Not as much. Okay.
Not as much.
All right.
It would get a lot, though.
Picture it.
Okay.
Summer Jam. Next year.
2023.
Yes. I bring you out on stage.
Okay.
I'm like, we're bringing back to the radio station Cipha sounds.
Yeah.
Everyone starts cheering. We bring you out. And I say, and that's not all. We have another surprise.
Yeah.
And I just get down and suck your on stage.
Hey, yo. Wow. Wow.
Right at Summer Jam in front of everybody.
I don't like this one. I don't like this one at all.
Do you think it would get the same attention as the Desus Mero Breakup?
To completion?
Go that far. You found the line. You found the line I'm not willing to cross.
Okay. No, I do not think it would get as much. I think it would get a lot. It would garner a lot of attention.
How long do you think we trend for?
At Summer Jam? Not long, because there's going to be some other shit at Summer Jam.
Now, what do you think the trend would be? Would it just be like...
Like, I think like on the news the next day, they're like, oh, last night, Hot 97 had their annual concert over at MetLife Stadium. So-and-so performed, so-and-so performed. Oh, Chris Brown did an amazing show. Little Baby did this. And Young Thug came out of jail and performed. And on a side note, a weird thing happened. Former radio morning show host... performed a lewd act on a disgraced radio host. It would definitely be sidebar.
Oh, that's really depressing. No matter what we
do. What is it that they did? They touch a certain crowd? You know what I mean? Like, Andrew Schultz is on fire right now.
Ugh, I saw him on a plane the other day. I assiduously avoided him.
He's on fire right now. He put out his special through his own website. He had like a pay-per-view. Ugh. It was fucking crazy.
Not a fan. I know he's your guy. Go ahead.
He built an army. Like, yeah. We don't have an army. We have a ragtag militia. Like, not even, like, we have the fraternity from the movie Old School. That's our army.
By the way, you're right. You're right. We have Blue, the big fat kid.
But they came together and they won in the end.
That was a great fucking review. Oh, it's going to be gone because I fucking replaced my phone and the stupid Apple people.
Oh, what happened?
Oh, no, here it is.
Apple?
I have it. This is great. Shout out to this comment.
Take back the stupid Apple people?
No, I hated my experience at Apple this week. I almost went.
Oh, you mean that you hate a particular person at the store?
It was just the whole store. The whole store was out of control. The comment, it was posted like a month ago and it's called Years Ago. And I'm going to throw this up on IG. DJ Dusk and Peter Rosenberg take you down memory lane into their future where the two try to work out their new show. Who knows where this adventure will end? I love that description.
Wait, say that again.
DJ Dusk and Peter Rosenberg.
Oh, DJ Dusk. Okay. I get it. Yeah.
Sife's character from 25th Hour. DJ Dusk and Peter Rosenberg take you down memory lane into their future where the two try to work out their new show. Who knows where this adventure will end?
What is that for?
It's just a review.
Of a review on Apple.
Of the podcast. Yeah, yeah, yeah. It's good though, right? Because
super inside, man.
Super inside, but it gave me perspective because we don't know where this adventure will end. And we are always the storyline of the show has become the show.
I mean, we did it.
We
created again a new genre of being so meta.
Yeah.
That the crowd is along the journey.
That's this is the most meta podcast.
We're
there
like the Truman Show, but we know we're being filmed.
Correct. Here's another comment I saw this week. Please stop talking about Jay-Z. We get it. We got it. Hov is the illest person to ever live, and his story and life are the pieces of the greatest rap career ever created. So please, please, for the love of God, give us a break from Jay-Z talk.
Wait, that's not to our, that's to the other podcast.
No, no. That's just our general Jay-Z nut sucking, I guess. How about these two guys, my favorite podcast, Dead or Alive. I made it to the last live pod at the Highline Ballroom all the way from Boston, but couldn't make it this time and was pretty bummed out. Hopefully Pete and Sife take the show to Boston. Sife, I promise you'll have your white audience for your comedy side. Hope to see y'all live again.
Love it. Love that.
This is a great comment from back in November. the comment, just the subject of the comment is sneaky big laughs. And then the whole comment is just AKA Juan Kvetch.
What?
You know what Kvetch means?
No.
That's a good piece of Yiddish. You don't know, huh?
No.
Kvetch is complain.
Ah.
Cipher, real quick. I have to go talk again endlessly for the next 4 hours. But
June?
Hmm?
You got a Billy June story.
Oh, yeah. Two things. One, after the Black Thought interview and Danger Mouse interview. First of all, Danger Mouse is almost as shy as Billy June. Second of all, after the interview, Billy June says to Black Thought, he's like,
hey, I'm gonna see you at the Newport Music Festival.
And Black Thought, coolest guy ever, is like, oh, word, you're coming through? Yo, man, take my number, man. You got to come through and say what's up. And wow. I listened to Black Thought voluntarily give his phone number to Billy June, who's like, wow.
Okay, I'll hit you up when I get up there.
And Black Thought's like, I'm gonna get you wasted. And I was like, Thought, text me photos if this happens. And when he left, he was like, I promise I'm gonna text you if I see this guy.
Black Thought's the best, man.
He's the coolest. Also the January 6th thing.
Yeah. What happened?
Bruh.
What's going on?
I we don't have time to do it right now. Well, next week, maybe we'll get into more of a recap of it. But just a small piece. Okay. My favorite part from yesterday, you know, besides when they absolutely established that Trump knew what was happening in the White House immediately, my favorite part was when they described how every single other person, essentially, except maybe Giuliani, every single other person was pleading with him to make a statement to make it stop. And they pull up the receipts, the text messages from people like, I'm talking about a crew of the world's worst human beings.
Yeah.
Sean Hannity, Laura Ingram.
Yeah.
Donald Trump Jr. All texting him going, you must. They were texting Mark Meadows, his guy, not him. You must say something. You have to stop this. You have to. And he just would not do it. And then they showed the outtakes of his speech.
Oh, I saw that.
An outtake when he's like, no, I can't say that. I'm not going to say that. Do I have to say
I already
that
said
word?
They got to pay. I already said
they got to pay. I'm not saying more than that.
Yeah.
Bro.
Wow.
It's they know what he was doing. They know what channels he was watching. They showed what news channel he was watching. They showed Fox News coverage.
Yeah, I saw
that. And Fox News's coverage is showing, even Fox News was like, this is really bad. Like, this is fucked up.
He's the Joker, man.
And then they also sum it up. I thought the hearing was done so well last night. They show at the end when he finally did release his statement. They have video from tons of fucking Trump lunatics there on January 6th being like, yo, Trump says we need to go home. Guess we should go. Like, it was really your decision to let this keep going. They would have listened to you.
They show that, like, people seeing his message.
Multiple and
like,
people okay, this looking is at done. Their phone like, look, Trump's talking. He said we need to go home. And that's when they start to go home.
Wow. We need so, that like, kind of army.
How can they? Oh, I know.
Holy shit.
Last night's, if you can find on like somewhere the highlights, it was it was just astounding shit. All right, that's my show calling me. I gotta go.
All right. Peace and blessings. Happy birthday.
Thank you.
Hopefully the water touches the earth. Juan Epp, man, subscribe, review.
I want everyone on this podcast listening to know. I am not going to get eaten by an alligator, neither with Sife, and I will not give him a blowjob at Summer Jam. I want everyone to know that.
Thank you. Good night, y'all. Good night. Bye.